All right. See what happens. Began to slip away, almost conform to expectation of the past. Need to relax a while, lie down in the grass. Three, four. Everybody everywhere. the way it's supposed to be. Silver on the shoreline, let us be talking about very free and easy. I don't know if it would ever happened if he would have, you know, not got the ball rolling on this. So,
Thank you.
By the way, he's got a birthday coming up, so I wish him a happy birthday.
Thank you.
So, what y'all been doing for the last 30 years?
Still rocking Animal Back.
Wow. I'm just glad that that y'all are here tonight, man. That you came out. You know, we both wish more than anything that we could have Rich and Boo here with us tonight. So we got a little bit of, they're here in spirit. But this is Rich's guitar right here, and then I got the inventory from one of Boo's road cases from when we were on the road with his drum inventory on it. And it's Boo's drum key on one of his lanyards. You know, Boo always had, he always had a lanyard on him. I think he might have even had, do you have one on the picture? Yeah.
He had a little one-hander on it and a little dick lighter.
Yeah, that lanyard got him in trouble a couple of times, yeah. So anyway, he had some illegal accessories taped on the lanyard. So, but yeah, so I guess, you know, I don't even know where to start, man, as far as, you know, the whole ride. I mean, I still, you know, I guess it's kind of like Neil Peart. I still always considered myself the new guy because Animal Bag already had a good following before I ever hooked up with him, you know, I mean. They had already established a good fan base around Charlotte and everything when Bruce was singing for them. A lot of y'all
came from the Bruce era and then overlapped into my era and everything. So there's some people out here that have been here for the whole ride. And wow, you know, I mean, here we are still doing it.
The era after your era was the Pantera era.
Yeah. Oh, but yeah, it is funny because you know, when I guess if y'all don't know any background on the band, which most of you do, but you know, you guys were already gigging a lot around Charlotte before I ever joined you, I guess. You know, I mean, I had heard of you. And
I think we were like out of a singer there for like 6 months or something.
Well,
we tried out
a few games. Maybe, yeah, because, I mean, and the whole thing with Bruce is just kind of, y'all were going, what, different musical directions, kind of?
Well, he was going back to college.
Ah.
I guess he didn't. He was serious about it.
Right. Yeah. So, but I was just.
Yeah. We weren't. But like Rich actually quit college to
do the band. Yeah.
His parents weren't happy about that either.
Yeah. Well, you know that. I was just out of high school, man. I mean, I had been playing with.
The Trust,
yeah. I was playing with a cover band around here doing, you know, we were gigging, man. You know, had this little red school bus, and we played, you know, some up in around Gatlinburg and stuff, down around Myrtle Beach, you know, and stuff like that. And so, you know, we were gigging, but we were just a cover band, you know. Nobody in the band was really that interested in writing original music. And I was wanting to write some original stuff. And anyway, I had gone to the Park Elevator one night, if anybody, yeah, when it was still the Park Elevator. And I'd gone to the Park Elevator to see, I remember who I went to see. I went to see Dirty Looks, the band Dirty Looks.
Yeah.
If anybody remembers Dirty Looks, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So I went to see Dirty Looks, and I ran into this girl that I knew there. Her name was Caroline Purcell. And we were talking. And she said, "Are you still playing?" I said, "Yeah." I said, "I'm, you know, still doing the cover band thing." And I said, "You know, just like, you know, we're gigging and stuff." I said, "But I just like to do some original music, you know." I said, "They just don't seem really interested in writing any music, and you know, I'd like to do something with some original music." She's like, "Well, I got these friends that have a band, and they're kind of looking for a singer right now." And she said, "They do a ton of original music." She's like, "The drummer will be here tonight. I'll introduce you to him." And so in just a little while, you know, Boo comes in and she, you know, introduces me to Boo. And, you know, so Boo's like, "Yeah, man, you know, we're holding auditions, you know, for a singer and everything." And I was like, "Cool." He's like, "Yeah, if you're interested, man." He's like, "Are you going to the David Lee Roth concert?" And I was like, "Yeah." And then this is talking to all y'all that remember the old Coliseum, okay? Which is like Independence Arena or whatever it is now. So he's like, "Well, cool, man." He's like, "I'll meet you in the tunnel between bands and give you a cassette of our stuff." I was like, "Cool." So I met Boo in the tunnel. Y'all all know what the tunnel was, down to the floor, you know, and everything. So I met Boo in the tunnel and got this cassette, you know, which was their, what, the CPCC tapes, I guess, you know. So had like, what, seven songs or something? I don't know.
Oh, I know those were the ones that we recorded with Gaston, like, at Wilmington.
No, that was when, I was already with you then. Yes, I did. It had to be the CPC.
You know, the 80s, man. What can I say?
I know, man. Y'all have no idea how hard it was to get together for tonight. But anyway, yeah. It was more of a challenge than we thought it was going to be. So, so anyway, he gives me this tape. And he's like, "Yeah, well, you know, we practice at my house, you know, living room," which was actually Boo's grandparents' house. Which over on Hillside, that place was infamous, man. Everybody in Charlotte has been to a party at Boo's house after a show. So anyway, so I go over there to go in and audition for the band. And they're like, "Well, which song do you know?" I said, "All of them." And he said, you learned all of them? I said, yeah, I know all of them. And so they just, you know, there was a few, like, of the loyal that, like, hung out at practice that were there, you know, kind of watching to see what it was going to be like, you know, to see if they signed off on it or not. And, you know, I can't remember if Rollo was there. Rollo used to be there a lot, though. Rollo would be sitting back there at the bar smoking cigarettes at Boo's house all the time. And then I remember Victor was there. Victor might have been there the first time I jammed with you guys. I think Victor was there.
And so Duckworth was there recently. I haven't seen him in a long time.
Yeah. And so I was like, just pick one. And, you know, so we just launched in and started playing this Animal Bag stuff. And it just, you know, just went good.
The thing that really, you know, got me was, like, for one, he knew all of the songs. Somebody died in your family and you had to miss the first time. So I was like, oh no, this guy's a fake. But then the next week he actually came and then he knew every song and he didn't have to hold a lyric sheet or anything. And it's like, we had Bruce, our old singer, who, still, you know, I love the guy and everything, but he had to use lyric sheets all the time.
But I just learned, I learned all the lyrics,
you know, all the songs.
And so, I mean, it went good. First time we jammed together, it went good. And so right after when we got done with it, you know, they're like, you know, well, cool. You know, you got the job if you want it. And I was like, hell yeah, I want it. You know, so anyway, so I remember like a couple of days after that, I can't remember. Boo called me. And Boo said, hey, man. Can you be ready to open for Crocus in 7 days?
Yeah.
And I said, yeah, man, I can be ready. And so that was my first gig with Animal Bag, was awesome. Opening for Crocus at the Park Elevator. So, you know, we opened for Crocus. And I actually just posted that flyer not long ago on Facebook. I still have the flyer from the first gig I did with them. And it was great because there was like all these people there. It was like freaking packed when we were playing because everybody was there to see what the new singer from Animal Bag was like, you know, and everything. So, and then I remember when we got through, it was like party at Boo's house. And like everybody freaking left and Crocus was playing like 50 people because everybody went back to Boo's house. And there was this giant party. And the parties at Boo's house was pretty infamous. You know, he lived with his grandparents, C.W. and Ruth. And they were the coolest people to put up with all the shit they put up with. I mean, we basically just took it. When you walked into the living room, there was a drum stage in there and PA flown from the ceiling and just amps in every corner. And it was just, you know, we just took.
We'd be jamming. I mean, we'd be playing like Sax and Ninja or whatever.
Right.
Grandma.
Right. She would come down from upstairs from the bedroom, go to the kitchen and get something to go back upstairs. You know, they put up with a lot, man, you know. And, you know, we would have these parties and stuff down there in Boo's room after gigs and stuff. And she would just let everything go on. But the next morning, whoever was still passed out and was there, Ruth would come down and go, all right, everybody get out there and want every beer can out of the woods over there next to the house. And you'd have to go around and pick up all the cans and everything and clean up out there, and you know, because she didn't want it looking like, you know, a big old hell hole around there.
Which was the other thing, too, because she hated how sticky the counters were.
Right, yeah. She said it. So we had to do a little bit of, you know, cleanup duty after the parties and stuff. But it was always a party over there, man. I mean, every time we practiced, it was a different, you know, sometimes you'd have troll there. Those were always the interesting ones, you know. I mean, when I met Troll, man, he was, you know, the faithful know who Troll was, Tommy Troll. And he was one of those guys, he was great as long as he liked you. And if he didn't like you, it was pure hell. And, you know, there was a lot of cool people like, there was a lot of interesting people like that were in and out over at Boo's house. So I got to, it was like instantly, and man, I'm still like, you know, at this point, I'm like 18 years old. Because, you know, I blew off college to go join this band with the goal that Boo told me, we're either moving to New York or we're moving to LA. We don't know which, but we're going to one of them. So I was like, cool. And so I had like kind of a game plan, you know, when I joined them. And I'm straight out of high school, you know. I mean, I can't drink, you know, legally drink or anything, you know. So it was pretty interesting.
We were able to help them out with that.
Yeah. They were big influences on me. So, yeah. So we gigged around Charlotte and started just playing, you know, all the I remember I had to get kind of, because I hadn't really played the Charlotte scene. And I remember one night we were going to some bar. I mean, we would just go, like, we were trying to book gigs or something. We were going to some bar, and I'd come to Charlotte to go with them. And I think we were going to some place called the Hobnail Boot. And I walked in, man. I'm still kind of, you know, long jet black hair. And I think I had some kind of, I think I had some kind of roughly looking pirate shirt on, kind of like looking like Ian Astbury from The Cult or something, you know. And I remember walking in, and I remember Otis going, are you going to wear that to the boot? And I was like, well, I'd plan to. And so evidently that wasn't a drink.
Consultant, obviously.
Yeah. Because Otis was living there, man. Otis, you know, Otis was living at Boo's house. When you walked right in the door, there was like this divider, like one of those, you know, Chinese-looking folding dividers. That when you went behind that divider, that was Otis's room. And it was like this, it was big enough for like a bed. And then he had CDs and crap just everywhere. And it was like a bed and just music shit. And that was all that was back there. And but every time he'd go over there, Otis would have something that he had just discovered. Like I could remember him turning me onto like Ultra Mega OK Soundgarden and stuff like that. You know, it was always some kind of stuff you hadn't heard that Otis would want you to listen to when you got there.
Like
yeah, it's still like that, and it's still probably got a gigantic CD collection. I'm.
I don't listen to CDs anymore. I listen to my phone.
Yeah, and see ya.
I have a lot of CDs.
Yeah. And, but it was always, you know, it was always, Otis was living there at Boo's house, and that was the jam room, and that's where we got to know half the people that we know here was from them coming over to practice and hanging out and stuff, and then going to the shows, then going back to the parties and all that kind of stuff. So, but yeah, we had a great time, you know, and all kinds of interesting stuff happened at Boo's house, you know, like, one that I was talking about not long ago to somebody was when we got into Voivod, and that was an interesting yeah, it was a real interesting stage, man, because Otis was like real into Voivod when he got into Voivod, and so Otis had this thing he wanted to listen to Voivod while he slept to see what kind of dreams it would make him have. Now, any of y'all that know what Voivod sounds like, you know, this guy, the guitarist Piggy, learned all of his chords from, like, the chords that were banned by the Catholic Church for being evil, you know, and stuff like that. It's like, me don't need a one. And so I think that lasted, like, one night. And Boo said, all right, dude, you got to cut that shit off, man. It's like, I cannot sleep with that shit going. And so the Voivod dream experiment didn't last long, but there was always stuff like that going on. Yeah. But anyway, let's play another song. What you want to play next?
I don't know.
I
just got we got to realize I'm a little
Mirror
older.
Shades.
I'm a little older now.
Mirror Shades.
That's last. We got to change instruments on that one. That's last. Yeah, we know that. We do first and last. Everything in between. Yeah, we do first and last. Everything else, you know. And we pick that out because, well, the first song starts with hello. And
let's do city song.
City song? Okay, let me get a drink of water.
City song is because we were, I liked it right off the bat, for one, but he was writing about missing home, you know?
It was right after we moved to L.A., and I was still living in Glendale. there was a whole bunch of us living in Glendale. We lived in one apartment. It was me, Rich, D, Katie, Gaston, and we were all living in this one apartment in Glendale. And I remember laying there in my room, just waking up one morning, you know, and just kind of being homesick, you know, and just, you know, thinking, wow, you're 3,000 miles away from anybody other than these guys, you know, that really gives a shit about you or, you know, has your back or anything. And so it's just kind of one of those moments that you just start feeling like you're, you know, even though you're around a lot of people, you start realizing how alone you are. And so that was the genesis of City Song, so we'll play it. Yeah. I guess after we moved to LA, you know, we gigged around for a while. You know, we did one pay to play the whole time we were there. The Zaris, the end. That's the, you know. And I, in a way, I'm glad we did it because we could at least say we played the Zaris. But, you know, I mean, we did it one time. We were like, screw this shit, man. We'll never, this is, you know, this is crazy.
You just sell tickets to a show of a band that nobody's ever heard of.
Yeah, so basically you just end up buying a bunch of tickets and giving them away.
To hustle these people. Like,
yeah, so you're just basically...
take whatever they gave you, too, because it didn't matter but at the end. You just gave them as much as you could.
Right, you just gave them everything you had. Yeah, so, you know, I mean, so... we did that one time, and then we said, screw that, man. We want, you know, there were other places that you could play that didn't do pay to play. There just weren't a lot of them. And you had to kind of...
It turns out that those were the cool underground clubs, and so it was actually way better for us to play there anyway.
Right, we just weren't playing the places that, you know, like, at the time we were out there, the other bands that went on to kind of do something were like, you know, Pretty Boy Floyd was playing all the, you know, Sunset Strip stuff, and, you know, not long before we got there, like, Warrant had gotten signed and all that kind of stuff. And then there was a band called Mighty Joe Young that was playing that ended up getting a record deal.
That was Stone Temple Pilots,
yep, because they couldn't use the name. Which, funny thing, their first album came out on the exact same day as our first album.
Yeah.
And here we are. But at least, you know, I mean, you know.
We're alive.
Yeah, me and you are. We're durable, you know, so. Yeah. But, you know, that they had a little bit more of an adventurous ride. Well, I won't say it was more adventurous. We had a pretty adventurous ride. We just didn't make no money, you know, so. Now, we planned for a career, man. We did it like old school bands.
Also, at Coconut Teaser, we played with Head Train.
Yeah.
You remember them? They became Blind Melon.
And then we also did.
Like, hey, that's the band with the singer that it sounds like James Joplin.
Yep. And then
when the album came out, I was like, they reminded me more of a Southern Jane's Addiction.
Yeah. And then we also played with Lock Up, which went on with a different singer to be Rage Against the Machine. We actually did some show with them, and we actually went to that party, didn't you, over there at the rehearsal space? Or were you at the party over there on Melrose?
There's a different party I was thinking you were talking about, but I'll talk about that after you're done.
Okay. But there, you know, I went to I don't know who was with me, man, but we went to a party over at Lock Up's rehearsal space, you know, which it was in like this old storefront that was, you know, boarded up down on Melrose. And inside, it was just all lit with black lights, and they had all these weird black light sculptures and paintings and stuff, everything. And they would play, and just had a bunch of people there partying. And I can remember, you know, like meeting and talking to Tom Morello and thinking what a cool guy he was, you know, because he's like really, really smart, you know. And he wasn't, you know, the typical rock and roller, because he wasn't just dude partying and everything. He's like walking around and talking to people and stuff. And he, you know, and this is before anybody cared who Lockup was. You know, they ended up getting a record deal with Geffen and did like one album. And then their record deal fell apart and the band fell apart. And then they got a new singer and became Rage Against the Machine. So, you know.
Well, I went to his 26th birthday party, Tom Morello, and it was in like Santa Monica somewhere at some house, and you know, it was like almost like a Beverly Hills-ish kind of house, and this cool backyard with like fountains and all this kind of shit. Anyway, I ended up smoking like some really good weed, which is very prevalent in LA. And everywhere now. I was real high, and I didn't really know anybody at the party except for Tom Morello. And so I was sitting in the backyard with the fountain, and then they had the little stereo playing, and it was playing the album, The Crowded House.
Yeah.
And I already was familiar with Crowded House, but I was real high, and it really came in, and I really got it. You know how it is sometimes when you're high?
Shit really means something to you.
Yeah, and it sticks with you for life, too. So I'm still a fan.
Right, exactly. But yeah, we used to go out, and I can remember going out. I remember we had so many friends that were out there for a while, and you know, like lived out there or just came and stayed extendedly and all that stuff. Like I, you know, the Fentons were living out there, and Howard from Shot Howard was living out there. We would hang out with all the North Carolina people because, you know, we were like, you know, people from North Carolina. And so, you know, we were hanging out with the Fentons, hanging out with Shot Howard. Anyway, this is how I ended up meeting my wife. Was we were out there, and we had heard another band from North Carolina was there. And so it was this band called Tipper Gore that was from Eastern North Carolina. You know, they were like a thrash band, you know. And they had a little write-up in Rip magazine, you know, there's little fresh blood areas in Rip and all that stuff. And we're like, oh, we should go meet these guys, you know, they're from North Carolina. So I remember I went to a Tipper Gore show and I met the guy that played bass and sang for him. His name was Andy. And his girlfriend at the time was a girl named Sandra. And so we got to know them and everything. So Sandra had a sister that was getting ready to move out there named Amanda. And so evidently, I must have been like Amanda's type or something. Yeah, so her sister told her, you know, there's this guy you gotta meet, you know, that we just met that's from North Carolina. He's out here playing with a band and everything. And so ended up, you know, meeting her, and you know, she came to a party over at the jam room and everything, you know. And actually, I think Boo was really hitting on her. But Boo was really hitting on everybody. Yeah. Yeah. Boo was our band gigolo.
I was scared to turn around.
Yeah. Yeah, Boo, you know. But Boo met a lot of people, you know. And so anyway, you know, long story short, you know, we ended up, when I moved out of the apartment in Glendale with all the people, it was because me and Amanda got an apartment over in Atwater Village. And that was, I guess I met her like in, what, 89? Into 89 or something like that. And then we moved in together in 1990. You know, got married in 96 and we're still together. So, been a long, long trip, man. You know, I had to, and what's so funny is you meet somebody from North Carolina out in Los Angeles. You know, I mean, I said I had to go 3,000 miles to find somebody from North Carolina I could put up with. So, you know, but it worked out good, you know, and she's right there. So, anyway. And we're still together. And so she's been around, you know, for this whole journey too, you know, this, so, you know, we're just gigging around LA, doing some occasional shows with some girls. We got to do that show at the Teaser with Body Count, you know. Yeah. We got to do shows. Yeah. Hot Rod Long got us that one. Yeah, there was this promoter named Hot Rod Long that, I know.
He didn't look as cool as his name.
Yeah. But we're still friends on Facebook. I'm still friendly. But he was actually the guy. He was working with, he was promoting shows. And then he was also working with like several labels. Like, as a, you know, I don't guess he was really an A&R guy. Maybe he was. Kind of talent acquisition because he had his ear to the ground. He was the one that was responsible for Caius getting a record deal. You know, Hot Rod was. But Hot Rod loved us, and Hot Rod got us all some really good shows. Hot Rod's the one that got us in Club Lingerie, which is where we ended up getting our record deal out of Club Lingerie. I think he got us in the Teaser. He might have got us in Raji's, you know, because we played Raji's that time. You know, Raji's is where like the Chili Peppers came out of Raji's.
Yeah. And I remember seeing Angelo hanging out there and Fishbone hanging out there all the time.
Yeah.
And the cool thing about Raji's was it was at the bottom of this hotel, and it was the main room. Round room, and it looked like the inside of
Genie's
bottle.
Yeah, it looked like a Genie bottle in there, Raji's. If you go back, I'm sure you can do a
little comfortable couch.
Yeah, I'm sure if you go look up on YouTube and look up, you know, at Raji's, there'll be all kinds of old punk bands that you've heard of that played Raji's, because it was a kind of more of an alternative and punk type, you know, room. And that's the kind of rooms we started playing a little bit more of than the hair band rooms, you know, because we were kind of getting away from all that. We had, you know, we were all real into like Jane's Addiction and stuff like that. So we were heading like, I mean, we still had that element, I guess, of hair metal to us, but we started moving further away from that and getting into this more avant-garde metal and stuff. And, you know, sorry.
We were weird, man.
And we had, you know, and then we were doing a lot of stuff that nobody else was doing out there, like three-part harmonies. Like, you know, we did a lot of the harmony stuff, and there weren't a lot of bands doing that. And so we were doing the harmonies, and then we didn't shy away from 15 billion different time signature and key changes and stuff like that, to the point that I remember one of the Fentons one time getting, like, almost pissed off. Because he's like, man, you guys will do like the coolest riff in the world, and you'll do it for two measures, and then you'll never do it again in the whole song, you know? He's like, you know, that riff was worthy of writing a song around, and you just threw it in there like a throwaway, you know? And, you know, it was like, but we did that kind of shit, you know?
So, kitchen sink writing style.
Like, yeah.
You know, everybody in the band got to say, you know, oh, well, I want to put something in there too, man.
Yeah. And it was like,
we'll do your weird riff twice, all right?
Yeah. And then, but you know, it's like, we would write something, and then we would tear it back apart and use the components of it to rewrite something else. So you'd have these songs that showed up later out that you went, well, wasn't that the beginning riff to Sex Ninja? And you went, yeah, it was the beginning riff to Sex Ninja, but we took it, and now it's this. And, you know, we would just restructure songs and use things like blocks. And reassemble them into different things until we came up with something we liked. And, you know, the songwriting was, it was definitely a group effort, you know. So it was one of those things. I read this quote from Jerry Garcia one time talking about the Grateful Dead. He said, if you're in love with your own ideas, the Grateful Dead is not the band for you. And that's kind of the way Animal Back was, because you would bring something in and everybody would just rip it apart. And it would come out as something completely different than what you had in mind when you brought it in. And so, but it was good, because that's how it always sounded like Animal Bag. Because, you know, I mean, it's the same thing a lot of bands have done. You know, the Beatles did Happiness is a Warm Gun, and they did I Want to Hold Your Hand. But somehow it always sounded like the Beatles, you know? And that's the way I think of Animal Bag. You know, there was some kind of weird thread of continuity that whether it was an acoustic something or whether it was just brutal metal, there was something that made it sound like us. And I think it was that everybody had such a hand in writing, you know. So, we'll do another song.
Sure. And don't forget about our sense of style.
Yeah, we'll get to that.
Luke could get away, you know, he worked at Lip Service, and it was just like a really hip LA clothing rock star place, and he would always come. Yeah.
But yeah, I was working at Lip Service. I got that. Actually, when we moved out there, okay, we sent Boo went out on recon like a couple of weeks before us. I know, sending Boo on recon, but Boo was like, you know, Boo had the most money because Boo had sold the most weed. So, you know, I mean, you wonder how, y'all know I'm not kidding, the ones that knew Boo. That's how he got the drum kit and how he moved to L.A. So, anyway, he wouldn't care if I told you now, since it's almost legal. So, Boo went out like two weeks earlier, so that he and Nicole and all them went out there. You went out too. Because I remember we had to load, didn't we load your car in the back of a box truck or something weird like that?
No, Boo's.
No, I had to pull Boo's Volkswagen van out when I brought that.
That's what we did. That is what we did.
We loaded your car
in the back of a rabbit
in the back of a 24-foot box truck, packed a bunch of shit around it, and moved it out there like that. So, anyway, they moved out.
So I could drive the truck. That's fine.
Yeah. And so they got out there and got an apartment so that when the rest of us got out there, we would have somebody's floor to crash on until we could get apartments, you know? So when we got out there, you know, for like a few days, we're sleeping on the floor and stuff in the apartment that Boo and Nicole and Otis
and Garner,
yep, we're all living in. And I remember I was just like obsessed with getting a job, like as soon as I got there, because I didn't have a whole lot of money. I'd spent everything I had to get out there. And I was like, I gotta get a freaking job, man. You know, I was like, anybody know anybody hiring? I mean, like, as soon as I walked through the door, I'm going, where can I get a job at? You know? And Nicole had been working down at the lip service store on Melrose at the retail store. And she's like, well, I think they're looking for somebody at lip service down at the warehouse in East LA. I was like, cool. And so I went down there, and like the first week I moved to LA, I got a job working at lip service. And I was 19. Yep. And I stayed there the whole time until the band got signed and I had to quit. And so I went from when I first went in, I was packing boxes and doing shipping. And when I left, I was the distribution manager for the company. And I was going like to New York twice a year and Las Vegas and stuff, doing trade shows and all this stuff, you know. So, and we were like sending clothes to Axl Rose, the guys from Guns N' Roses, and the guys from Faster Pussycat were always down at the warehouse.
They were those, like, those tight pants that said slut and stuff.
Yeah,
on
and war and war stuff, you know. That was the stuff that I was selling that shit. So, but I got to meet a lot of cool people because they were always.
That was hip back then.
Yeah, they were always down there at the warehouse. You know, you got to meet a lot of those people. So anyway, but we'll get on to our sense of style here in just a minute. Let's do, go ahead and try Oddball, get it out of the way. Out of all the songs we're going to do tonight, this is the biggest chore. And the only reason that I learned this is because so many people said, you're going to do Oddball? And so, a lot of this stuff, I never played guitar on it, man. You know, I'm having to like figure out rich guitar parts, and like I am nowhere near even a piece of the guitarist Rich, you know, was. Rich, to me, playing with Rich was like what it must have felt like for Ozzy to get Randy Rhoads or something, you know. I mean, Rich was that freaking good, man. It's the best guitarist I've ever played with. And then he could sing the high harmonies, he could write, he could play acoustic instruments, he could play anything he picked up, he could play it.
Yeah,
you know,
banjo.
I mean, pissed me.
He started
fucking
playing
off.
Banjo.
Oh yeah,
when
he
was could seven.
Play banjo. He, you know,
that's why he when he picked up a guitar when he was 14, it wasn't a problem.
Yeah, but actually it should have been a problem because a banjo's tuned absolutely nothing like a guitar. But it's just, you know, Rich just had a mind for that shit, man. The guy could play anything he picked up, and within 2 days he could sound like he had been playing it for 5 years. You know, I mean, it was, you know.
It's true.
So anyway,
I was gonna say something about Oddball too.
You wrote that. Tell about it.
Like, but it's funny because that's the most autobiographical song that I ever wrote, and nobody ever really thinks about it that it's me. Because he sang, you know.
Yeah, but Otis wrote a ton of lyrics, man. Otis Otis had notebooks full of lyrics.
Still do.
And see, it's funny how different people write, because Otis just had all these lyrics, and somebody could come up with a riff, and Otis could go, oh, just a minute. I think I got something that'll go with that. And he could go through this notebook full of freaking lyrics, you know. Whereas everything I wrote was just purpose written for at that time, and I could not sit down and for me, it's like I can't just decide I'm going to sit down and write a song.
Was it on a napkin?
Huh? Yeah, but it's totally, you know, half the time.
Written on a napkin?
Yeah, or either you just try to memorize it and not forget it. You know, you keep singing it over and over in your head. But when I write stuff, it's like the shit just comes in like one big, you know. It's
did you hear that sound effect?
Yeah.
Now normally there's a splash.
Yeah, that's what it's like though, man. It's like everything just, you know, like, and then your stomach doesn't hurt, you know, once you write that song, you know. So but that's what it's totally like for me, man. I cannot sit down and write, you know, go, I want to write a song. I'll write something and I'll look at the next day and then, oh, this is pure shit right here, and throw it away, you know. And so, you know, the best stuff that I write and the songs that have hung around, I mean, they just happen at the most inopportune times. Like you'll be in the shower and you'll have some kind of riff going in your head, and then all of a sudden all these lyrics just come and you're like, oh God, I gotta write this shit down, you know, before I forget it. And, you know, that's how it works for me. Whereas Otis, I always envied that he could just sit down and write all these, like, you know, he did it like I thought a songwriter should do it. You know, they should have books full of almost like poetry and stuff. And Otis would have it. And now some of his poetry was pretty vulgar and stuff like that. But, you know.
It's Otis. But it's interesting because the song Oddball is me getting on to myself for all of the times that I didn't write an idea down.
I know.
And that's why I was like, why it says you got to answer when the light goes on, you know. And yeah, a lot of times it's like, oh, I'll remember it tomorrow.
Yeah, and you don't. Yeah. I know. It's
I remember when I wrote that, though, I worked in a warehouse, and I was hid in a little area and was kept thinking of the lines while I was pulling my orders, and I would run over there and write
another line down. Yeah. But this was a rich guitar part, though, and I had to figure this thing out. So if anybody's out there looking for a verbatim copy of what Rich was doing, don't watch this. Some things you just got to deal with. So
I'm kind of going to do the Otis part, though.
All right.
Once I catch a song, I gotta let it go.
Here we go now.
Wake up, boy, this is your conscience. The parrot on your shoulder who nags at you to win. Lose it for a moment, but a moment seems a lifetime. Side of bed, here we go again. Here we go again. Nights I spent so drunk from gas of wonder. Morning manager cracks a whip if I not to go under. And if and when my ship pulls in, we'll load our rabbit bait. My poos up to the sky, throw on my mirror shade. Well, some like to play it safe. But I did that danger. light goes on. Gotta answer when the light goes on. Gotta answer when the light goes on.
When the light goes on.
Whoa, whoa, yeah,
yeah. When the light goes on.
Gotta answer when the light goes on. Oh, me. So, anyway, we were talking about the cool clubs and stuff. I guess I should get on to, we ended up getting signed out of Club Lingerie. It was a really cool club. It was on Sunset, but it was way down at the end. Kind of away from all the other stuff. And we had been jerked around for weeks, months, by Warner Brothers. Warner Brothers acted like they wanted to sign us. And to the point that they rented us a rehearsal space and all this stuff. And they wanted us to do a showcase for them. We went down and did an acoustic set in Ted Templeman's office. And, you know, for like A&R people. And then they got us this rehearsal studio, and we were sharing it with the Chili Peppers. Remember that? That Chili Peppers drum set was in there, and Flea had just had a kid. And I remember over there on the wooden stool in front of Flea's amp was like a book on parenting. You know, it was like reading and practice and stuff, you know? So we were sharing this rehearsal space. I mean, we never met them. They weren't there, but their shit was there, you know? And so anyway, they had us do this showcase at this cool place called The Alley. And it's like the place that the Eagles and Linda Ronstadt and Little Feet and all them, they used to hang out there. It was like their jam room and hangout place and stuff, and they turned it into a showcase studio. So we did this showcase for Warner Brothers, and like all the A&R people come, you know, and everything.
And it was catered and stuff.
Oh yeah, it was like a big deal, you know. And we just knew that we were getting ready to get signed to Warner Brothers, you know, because this had been going on. They had been like, we couldn't talk to anybody else, couldn't talk to any other labels, nothing, you know. And they were like, you know, they had us locked down, you know, for a month, like 2 months. So we do this showcase. We thought we kicked ass. And so we're sitting around. And so all of a sudden, Henry, our attorney, calls one day and says, yeah, Warner Brothers passed. And we're like, what? Why? I didn't really give an excuse. They just passed.
Yeah, I knew some girls like that.
So, needless to say, we were pissed off, man. We were pissed off because we hadn't been able to talk to any other labels or anything for a couple months. And we'd been jacked around by Warner Brothers, you know, thinking something was about to happen. Then they just go, yeah, we passed. So we were pissed. And so we were just like, you know what? You know what? Screw the whole freaking music industry. Screw everybody. Screw it. Screw that. Screw it all. And we had a show like booked at Club Lingerie. And we were so pissed off when we went to play that show. And we got up there on stage and we're like, it was almost like a, you know, fuck you to the whole music industry establishment. We just hated them all at that time. We hated everybody that had anything to do with the music business. So we got up there and we did this show. And it was like the most angry, pissed off show that we've probably ever done. We didn't know that this guy, Bobby Carlton, who was an A&R guy, had brought Bob Scoro, who was the president of Mercury Records, to the show to see us that night because he wanted to sign us. We didn't know this. So we get up there and we're just like, this fuck you show, you know, pissed off, don't care, you know.
and just got up there and just did a brutal show. No concern about commercial potential, nothing. You know, just got up there and just... And so Bobby's out there with Bob Scoro, neurogenous, you know. And he said Bobby was like, I mean, Bobby said Bob Scoro was like, man, I can't believe there's that much sound coming out of three musicians, because I was just running around singing. I wasn't playing nothing, you know, on most of this stuff, you know. It was Otis, Rich, and Boo. It was a three-piece. And Bobby said, you know,
power trio.
Yeah. And it was super-duper power trio that night, you know. And so Bobby said that Scoro just kind of stood there watching us, just kind of like, you know, holy shit, you know. And he said that before the show's over with, he elbowed him and said, if you want them, go get them. And so the next day is when we got the call to talk to Mercury about, you know, record deal.
Yeah.
And so we had a kick-ass attorney, man. Henry Root was our attorney. And Henry's the coolest dude in the world. He went on to be the attorney for VH1 and Viacom and all that stuff. You know, he did a whole bunch of really big stuff. But Henry was our attorney. And he was so cool.
Our manager was, her name was Annie.
Yeah.
And she told us that, yeah, Scoro gave the go-ahead that they could sign you. And I remember like, yeah, right, I'll believe that.
Yeah, so did Warner Brothers, yeah. We were so skeptical at that point, you know. We were like, I believe it, but we're signing it, you know. And so, but anyway, Bobby, the guy that ended up being our A&R guy, he had some clout because he had just signed a band called Ugly Kid Joe.
Yeah.
And Ugly Kid Joe's first radio single, I Hate Everything About You, was doing really good. So all of a sudden, they were listening to what Bobby had to say, you know. When Bobby came in and said he wanted to sign us, well, they must be good. Bobby wants them, you know, I mean. So anyway, we ended up getting signed to Mercury. Actually, well, the record deal was, the record deal, I guess, is with PolyGram, because that's the parent label. And then, you know, there's Mercury. And then we actually ended up being on Stardog, because they thought that with what we were doing, it was more of a fit for us, and it would make us have more of an appeal with the underground and stuff, because Stardog Records had been the label founded by a band called Mother Love Bone, which went on to be Pearl Jam. And so if you were gonna get signed to Stardog, the guys, the remaining members of Mother Love Bone, had to give them the okay. So basically Pearl Jam had to say, you were okay for your album to come out on Stardog. So they listened to what we had to do, dug it, and gave the thumbs up. So we got signed, you know, for our album to come out on Stardog. And there weren't many.
Have you guys noticed if the beer fairy is like running around here somewhere?
You need one? If somebody could beer fairy it, is what you want?
I don't know.
Whatever cold, beer fairies cold. Distribute.
Thank so, that's my lovely girlfriend, Suzanne, right there.
But just one real quick funny story about getting signed. And Rollo was in on this. Rollo was our drum tech for years, y'all. Rollo moved to L.A. with us just to do the same shit we did, just help us out with it and everything. So Rollo was partner in crime for this whole adventure.
Yeah.
And so anyway, Rollo and Boo had gotten really good at growing medicinal herbs. They had like some indoor operations that may or may not have been doing. Yeah. But he did almost get arrested for it.
Look, if you look at Rollo's thumb, you'll notice it's green.
Yeah. So they had prepared this thing in a little glass vial called the signing fatty. And it was exactly what you think it was. If we ever got signed, that was what they were going to smoke right after we signed the record deal. And they meant it. Even if it was in our attorney's office overlooking the Santa Monica Pier. And so The only thing that we were planning for the long haul, man. You know, we didn't ask for a bunch of money. We didn't sell off any publishing. We're like, you know, well, 10 years from now, we'll be glad, you know, like we're going to have a 10-year career. You know, we'll be glad we didn't do that, you know. And so all these other bands are getting signed and buying like Corvettes and stuff like that. And we're like, no. We'll have to pay all that back. We don't want any money. What did we want? The entire Rush catalog. Everybody in the band wants the entire Rush catalog. Nice. So what did we got when we got signed?
I still got mine.
We sat there, and when we came into the table in our attorney's office to sign, in front of each of our places we had to sit, all four of us, to sign the contracts, there was a stack of everything Rush ever released on Mercury Records for each one of us. That's what we asked for. Not money.
And then we smoked the fatty, and then our lawyer kind of started getting worried and like starts opening the
he was freaking out.
Windows and like
we're like in a conference
turning
room.
Fans on and all this.
Yeah, we're in a conference room, and I kid you not, when you open the double doors at the conference room, there was a little porch, and you are looking right on to the Santa Monica Pier with the sign that says Santa Monica Pier that you see in the movies and stuff. If you ever see something filmed from the opposite end of the Santa Monica Pier looking back towards, if you see a building with double doors that go out to a balcony, that's where we were smoking the signing fatty. It was right behind those double doors up there. And so Hendrix was kind of freaking, going, oh, man, y'all just hurry up and do this. You know, and so anyway, so we signed our record deals and took our Rush CDs and went home and started thinking about recording the album. So, I guess at this point we should probably do another song.
Okay. What are they?
Let's do If I, because that one's got an interesting backstory. Because everybody gets the meaning of this song. Well, not everybody. Probably everybody. But the song If I, actually saw a really shitty write-up about it one time, where everybody was, you know, where they were just trashing it on being, you know, chauvinist and this and that and the other and arrogant and all this. Yes, really crappy, which I'm just glad I got a write-up. I didn't give a shit what they said about it, but, you know. But what this song is actually about is being too big of a wuss to break up with somebody. So you'd rather just piss them off and have them go away so you don't have to hurt their feelings. It's about being like
a total dude strategy.
It's a total dude strategy, and there's probably a mental term for it, and it's probably really unhealthy behavior and all that stuff. But when you're so afraid, like a relationship's not working out or something, but the other person in the relationship still really into the relationship, and you're wanting to break it off, and you're not wanting to hurt their feelings and like crush them and
well,
stuff.
Well, it's still gonna happen.
So you decide that the proper way to break up with them would be to just piss them off to the point that they break up with you, and then they're not feelings are not hurt. You'd rather be pissed off at you than have their feelings hurt. So that's what this song is actually about. If I is about being too big a wuss to just do the right thing and break up with somebody and tell them the truth. So you just try to piss them off to the point that they break up with you. So this is If I. I get a drink of water first. We're gonna have to do a part two to this thing. We got so much shit to talk about. Of a clown. keep coming back for more. And if I told you that the world was flat, the way you sat, you try to see the edge. Would I see you on the news out on the ledge? I beat you down, I pushed you round, still you're coming back for more.
You know, most of the harmonies and stuff were sung by Rich. Yeah. He had a lot higher voice than yeah. either of us.
Like an impossibly high voice, yeah. So, yeah, man, you don't know what we'd give to have those guys back, man, because, it's you watch all these bands from the era that you were playing in going back and doing reunion shows and reunion tours and all that stuff, and you know, half the band's gone, and you know, it's not even an option for us, you know, and it's not like you can just get another drummer and another guitarist and have it be Animal Bag. It just doesn't, but with this band, it doesn't work that way.
It would be, you know? It would reek of us like trying to cash in on something.
And it wouldn't even sound right, man. You know, I mean, honestly, there are certain bands that you come across, and you know that it's those four people or however many people there are in the band, it's that bunch, and anything that monkeys with that tears apart the sound of the band, you know. And Animal Bag was those four people, and you know, we could do stuff that sounded close to Animal Bag, stuff in the vein of Animal Bag, just like we're doing tonight. You know, I mean, it's a
half
nod
bag. It's what I call it.
Yeah, it's a half bag. And you know, it's a nod to Animal Bag. But you know, even tonight, that's why, you know, when we were talking to Stick about doing this, we said, well, we don't want to bill it as an Animal Bag show, you know, because you know it's not, you know, so. But anyway, so we got signed and recorded a record. We could go into all that too. Like I said, we'll have to do another one of these sometime and go into detail or something. But then we went on the road. And they stuck us on the road before the album even come out. And we are honestly going to clubs playing for $100 a night. Wow. You know, we got an album getting ready to come out on a major label. And we're playing for $100 a night because nobody knew who we were. You know, the album hadn't come out yet. And so it's just like they just stick us out. We had the shittiest booking agent. Who wasn't at that time? That, like, honestly, man, we would play in one town, and then we would drive 5 hours to play somewhere else, and then we'd go back through the town we played the night before to go 7 hours to play somewhere else. And it was like they were just throwing darts, going, yeah, I haven't played there for $100. No, that was John Bell, Family Tree. John was good. That was when we finally got to it. Yeah.
He did have a cool
yeah,
hat.
But we
that
started.
Cool hat.
But yeah, we were playing just anywhere to anybody for like $100, and that was back when they still gave you tour support. Thank God. And so, you know, I mean, it was just adding to our bill. You know, we were going to, you know, with a record company's nothing but a bank. You're paying all that shit back. You know, it doesn't matter what you, every promo poster and sticker, you're paying it back.
That John Bell guy who booked us, he was from Burlington, Vermont, which is like where Fish is from. And so, again, yeah, we played there at that place. Nectar's.
Well, we went to Nectar's. We didn't play at Nectar's, but we went there with John Bell that night. And
what's the name of the place there?
I don't remember what the name of that.
Anyway, the cool thing is that we got to go to Montreal, which is right across the border. And so we had this, my bass tech, his name was Catfish, and he stayed with all the drugs in America while we went through the Canadian border. And then we got detained because we were a rock band and we were suspicious.
And it was crazy getting into Canada at that time, man. They took us all in separate interrogation rooms and interrogated all of us and then compared our answers to make sure they matched up before they would let us into Canada. They were not good. They wouldn't let our guitar tech into Canada because of a previous infraction he had from like 8 years ago on his record. And what we have to pay, like $700 or something to get fits into Canada?
I don't remember what it was.
It was something crazy.
But I remember they were in, after they interviewed everybody, and they were interviewing me last, and asking, have you ever been arrested? And what he really had meant was, have you ever been convicted of a felony or something like that?
Right.
And I was like, dude, we're in America, everybody gets arrested. You mean, have we ever been convicted? You know, he was one of those French dudes, and so he was just using the wrong word, you know?
But yeah, it was a bitch. It took us hours and hours to get into Canada to play one show and then drive back home the same night. We had to pay all this money. Everybody in the band made it through fine. Fitz is the one that cost us the money to get in. You had to pay to get Fitz into Canada. So anyway.
My favorite Montreal memory, though, is when it was me and Rich were walking around outside of the venue.
QE2.
And then there were these two foxy Montreal French chicks came and were like talking, and then we ended up like smoking a hash joint with them and stuff. And I said, you know, they didn't speak English. And so I said something kind of sexy. And so, kind of, it's funny. If you can imagine me saying something sexy.
Otis's idea of sexy. Yeah.
Well, anyway, here's the funny part is Rich thought, like, oh, I can, Otis just said that. I can say anything I want. And he starts like talking all this shit, and then they understood what he said.
But yeah.
Hey, baby.
But yeah, the tour eventually got better, man, you know, because, you know, we started off just kind of gigging before the album came out on our own. And then we ended up getting hooked up, you know, Bobby, our A&R guy, was the guy that signed Ugly Kid Joe. So we ended up on the Ugly Kid Joe tour. It was actually three bands on the bill. It was Collision, Animal Bag, and Ugly Kid Joe. And we're the only ones in a little RV because we didn't want to spend no money because we knew we were going to have to spend, pay that shit back. You know, we had a 10-year plan. It's like, first band, tour bus, Ugly Kid Joe, tour bus. animal bag, class C RV that's about to fall apart, you know. And,
you know, it's like the Beverly Hillbillies or something.
Yeah, driving ourselves around. I can remember parking in a parking lot in Madison, Wisconsin, and everything in the RV froze, man. Shampoo, everything in there was so freaking cold, you know. And so the RV finally blew up going into Amarillo, Texas. It threw a rod. And we limped into Amarillo, and then we had to finish out the rest of that tour in like two little vans. We had a little minivan for a little while, and I remember I was sleeping like behind the back little seat in the minivan. We had stacked up luggage and put a little piece of plywood on top of it, and I would sleep back there with my feet pulled up like this, and I was like right up against the hatchback door. And I'm thinking, man, if somebody accidentally hits that hatchback release while we're going down the road, me and all this shit's just going to fall out into the road, you know. And you'd have to just get really, really tired before you could go to sleep for thinking about that. But eventually you just pass out because you were so tired, you know.
Yeah,
so
I want to apologize to Luke, too, because we were all smokers except for Luke. And he had to ride around in that van with us all.
I was a secondhand smoker when that tour got finished. Yeah. So, the Kid Joe tour was cool. There was, it was cool because we're playing bigger rooms and stuff like that. And the majority of the guys in Ugly Kid Joe were really cool guys. Although, I do have one beef with Whitfield Crane, the guy that sang for Ugly Kid Joe. And I see it now as a missed opportunity the band probably could have made it if I would have jumped on this opportunity. We were at the boathouse in Virginia Beach. Norfolk. Yeah, it was Norfolk. That's, you're right. Virginia Beach is where we did the surf contest with Blue Oyster Cult and Goo Goo Dolls.
Yeah, we had Blue Oyster Cult on a trailer on the beach.
Yeah. But this is in Norfolk at the boathouse. And see, the thing we had going for us as an opening act, we only had to play like 45 minutes each night. So we didn't even have to pace ourselves. We could just get up there and just go, you know, just go balls out from the time you hit the stage. You could just go nuts, you know, for 45 minutes. So we were getting a really good response, you know, when we would open these shows. You know, we were making a lot of fans. Boathouse, we did particularly good that night. I don't know what we did, but man, we were killing it. And the fans were going nuts, and people are stage diving, going crazy and everything. And so we were like feeling really good when we came off the stage that night. You had to go down this little ramp, you know, off the stage to go backstage. And I remember I was coming down that ramp, you know, I'm all happy and shit because we just had a killer show, you know, the crowd was going nuts and everything. And Whit's like standing down there at the bottom of the ramp, leaned up on the rail. And I'm walking by all happy and everything. And he goes, "Ooh, can I touch you?" And does me like that on the chest and then walks off. And I'm just kind of flabbergasted, man. I'm like, what a fucking asshole, you know? And I'm just standing there, and I'm too floored that he's such a dick to do anything when I realized, you know, later on, that I should have punched him. Because if I would have hit him right then, that shit would have been all over MTV, and we would have been a household word. That's the band that just got kicked off the Ugly Kid Joe tour for decking the freaking singer, you know? I said, missed opportunity, you know? And I really hate that I didn't hit him, but I didn't. But that tour ended, let's talk about how that tour ended, because it's interesting. Rollo has something to do with that. We were coming into Long Island, New York, do a show, and we were running a little bit late. We were going to miss sound check because I don't remember why the band had gotten delayed. Well, the crew at this time, Rollo and Fitz and all them, they're in like a rental truck, like a rider truck, you know, with all of our gear in it, and actually had a little bunk beds built in the back. Catfish would sleep in the back, you know. So anyway, they had gotten to the venue that afternoon and like turned too tight coming into the parking lot and had run over some dude's car with like the crew truck, with like the step that hangs down on the side and like gone across the guy's hood or something. And they tore the shit out of somebody's car coming into the parking lot for the show. So they had told us, all right, you guys are, you know, not going to be able to play the show tonight. We were basically being punished for being late and for our crew running over somebody's car. So we got kicked off the show for that night in Long Island. It was just going to be Collision.
Sparks was the name of the club.
Sparks, exactly.
And that was the night that we turned Tommy on to acid.
Exactly. Awesome. This is how the tour ends, y'all.
We went to the show anyway.
So. Yeah. We had been in tripping. Vermont and had scored some really good acid in Vermont. So we had really good acid just waiting for the time to do it. So we figured the night we couldn't play the show would be a good night to eat acid and go to the show anyway. So we all, and our tour manager had never done acid before.
That's my favorite part.
And we talked him into it.
And he's one of those guys, he's like a little boy, when he gets excited, his voice gets real high. And he'd be like, guys, is it really supposed to be doing that?
Yeah, he's real analytical. He's like, okay, now am I supposed to be seeing this now? Because, okay, is this right? And, you know, and he's like, you know, and so we decided to go. This is like a sold out show on Long Island, you know. And so we show up, we ain't got to play. So we're all blazing out on acid and show up at the show and go in to watch the show from the crowd, you know. So we walk in there, we're all like, you know. And so Collision does their thing, goes fine. Then Ugly Kid Joe gets on stage. And like about three songs into Ugly Kid Joe's set, some dude throws a beer bottle at him from out in the crowd and it whacks Klaus, the guitarist, in the head. And like pretty much knocks him out, man. The guy goes down, and like, you know, first aid guys come out and shit, you know, they're like, oh shit. And so after the brief break for the medical guys to come attend to Klaus, Whit, the singer, comes back on stage and he said, some asshole hit Klaus in the head with a bottle. Somebody's a dick. We're done. Flips the crowd off, and they walked off stage after playing three songs. Needless to say, the crowd was not happy.
And we were very sensitive to that because we were tripping.
Yeah, we're standing in the middle of a riot.
It was like we were all peace and love and shit, and then all of a sudden you could just feel the room just like change.
Things went riot level real quick. And all of a sudden we started hearing shit breaking and shit. And like all this stuff, and we're going, oh man, we got to get out of here, man. We got to get out of here. And so like we're like trying to get out of the club. We're going through all the people and shit. And like people are getting hurt and angry and shit. You know, and there's fights breaking out and stuff. We're like, we got to get out of here, man. We got to get out of here. And we're like, we get out to the sidewalk. And as soon as we get out to the sidewalk, there's like some dude getting his ass beat out in front of the club because the people think that he's the one that threw the bottle. So they're out there beating this guy's ass. And like cop cars are rolling in and blue lights. And we're like, ah, you know, like we're freaking out. And Tommy, the tour manager that had never done acid before, is really freaking out, you know. And we're just like, you know, ah. And so after that, Ugly Kid Joe canceled the rest of the tour. And that was the end of the Ugly Kid Joe tour. That's how it ended. In grand fashion.
And now he's going to post it on YouTube.
Yeah.
They're going to see, hear the whole story.
Yeah, anybody that didn't want that posted, oh well. Everybody knows how that shit ended now. It was fun. That's rock and roll, you know. And in case y'all don't know, there actually is a book, and I wish I could remember the guy that wrote it. This dude wrote this book about bands that had really shitty experiences in the record business. No, it wasn't Rick Reeder. Now, Rick Reeder's another story.
Sound man from hell, never mind.
Yeah, But there was a guy that wrote this book, and we actually have a whole write-up in that book about how shitty our luck was. So, yeah. Anyway. Okay, so hopefully get Joe to his Uncle Biff. What have we not done?
8th Street!
I think we might be down to mirrors.
Darker days. Everybody.
Cosmo, Wood, Hip Hop, Oddball, City Song. Okay, yeah, this is a good one. This is off the EP. This is off of Offering, which we recorded in you could probably.
It was in an apartment.
Yeah, but it was pretty much in hours. I mean, we didn't spend.
Yeah, it didn't take long.
We had a budget of $5,000 for the whole album, including artwork or something like that. It was Offering was not even supposed to be a release. Offering was supposed to be a giveaway that they were going to give away with the first album as an incentive. And so they gave us this minuscule recording budget and told us, you go, guys, go find you somebody to record it for you. Make it kind of like a demo tape. You guys do the artwork. We'll just package it like a little, live CD with your other one. Give it away. I'm like, okay, cool. They give us this little budget. We go find this dude. We recorded in his living room in an apartment in LA and Hollywood. We had to record during the day when his neighbors were gone so we wouldn't upset everybody. So we recorded this thing in a couple of days. Offering was recorded in a few days. And then we delivered it to the record label and they listened to it and they went, holy shit, you guys did this whole thing for $5,000? They're like, we're not giving this away. This is your next release. And we're like, oh, great, man. We thought it was a giveaway. And so it ended up being our next release, which was awful. And so earlier when we were talking about Troll, this is a song in memory of Troll. Troll was killed in a truck accident. And a friend of ours called him. These are Rich's lyrics, and based on the phone call that Rich got, because a friend of ours, Chris Dewar, called from Charlotte to tell us that Troll was dead. And Rich wrote this song basically based on the phone call he got from Dewar telling him that Troll was dead. So this is called Tom. And I still think Three Doors Down ripped us off, because if you've ever heard the song Loser, it's the exact same damn chords, and we wrote Tom first, so anyway. You hear that? Three Doors Down did it. But we did it first. Just reaching my hand out. We'll go ahead and there's so much more we can talk about, man. There was, you know, I mean, I look back on it and it's almost like when you look back on it, it's almost like it happened to somebody else. It's like, you know, it doesn't seem real that you actually lived through all that stuff and did all that stuff and, you know, had all those good times and those things happen and there's so much stuff we hadn't talked about.
It's funny when Rich got that mandolin.
Like I remember, like the first day that he got the mandolin, he was like
looking at this book, and trying to like learn, figuring out how to tune it and everything. And then, like you know, had a book like with some the chords and all that kind of stuff. And then I didn't see him again until like the next day. And then the next day, he could play every song that you've ever heard that had a mandolin.
I mean,
all this is Zeppelin and Heart.
Yeah.
I mean, he could play everything.
It was unreal, man.
And so we're like, we got to write a song for the mandolin. And so I had these lyrics that I had written, and it was called Mirrored Shades. I remember when I wrote it, it was a day that I worked for a tree company, and we had a blizzard in Charlotte, and I didn't have to go to work that day, but I couldn't get out of my driveway, and there was snow everywhere, so I decided to walk to Waffle House, and when I was walking to Waffle House is when I came up with these lyrics, and the way that I came up with them was it was all snowy, and I had just been listening to U2's album, War, and it's a gatefold, and inside they're all like in the snow. And so it was reminding me of U2.
And so I wrote,
when I wrote those lyrics, I was thinking of the melody of New Year's Day. And I wrote.
This is how his mind works.
Well, no, but it's not that really. It's not. I was using their phrasing as a format for these lyrics. So when I actually wrote it to the U2 melody, but so it would have been like, shoot the alarm, now don't be afraid. New worlds to conquer, beds to be made.
This is how stuff changes when we all get together.
But when he had the mandolin and I just brought the lyrics, and then me and Boo, we got drunk. We didn't get to hear them finish it. And they the next day, they're like, oh, yeah, we finished it. And so the next day, I heard it for the first time. So I didn't have any part in the music, really. Except for at the end, when they showed me, I was like, oh, well, let's do this part here, repeat.
That was my
only real contribution other than the lyrics.
And all I did was just kind of follow what Rich was doing with chords on the guitar. You know, that was one of the few that I played on. And Rich already had the whole friggin' thing just pretty much mapped out. You know, he knew how it was going to be. And he just played the mandolin stuff for me. And all I did was just hold down, you know, the basic chord changes and stuff with the guitar part. And just did some little hammer on things. And, you know, I mean, and all of a sudden when you played it together, it just sounded like a song. You know, it was just like instant.
I was also, when I was walking to Waffle House in the snow, because the snow was so bright, I had on some road shoes. And that was the only reason why that song was called that. Because it really wasn't about that.
See, you'd never imagine that all that shit could just come out of one walk to the Waffle House, man. He hadn't even eaten yet. You know? This is just getting there.
The funny part is, like, I could be wearing those shades, and I don't even have to be paying attention to you or anything. You can't tell.
Yeah.
And I love that.
Shall we play it? This is Janice's favorite song. So Janice has been around for a long freaking time, y'all. Because Janice used to come over to Boo's house to practice and everything, you know. I mean, there's a bunch of people in here that were at Boo's house a lot. Janice is like Stick here. They have done a lot for the local music scene around here as far as promoting bands, promoting shows, booking bands, you know, supporting venues. So anyway, so we're
making the band cookies.
Yeah, I have cookies over here. I have two things of cookies for when I get home. So
thank you.
All right, so this is Mirror Shades.
Thank you.
All right. You guys, they probably want to go home. We could stay here and talk all night, so.
But we're old now.
Yeah, we need to sleep.
I am anyway.
Yeah, man, there's so much we didn't get into, so we'll have to do this again sometime.
I'm just 1 year older than you.
We'll play the same songs again because that's all we can play, but we'll talk about different shit. How about that? Yeah, we'll just, you know, pick up later and just kind of go through when the record deal falls apart and that whole shit show starts. Yeah, so we didn't get there, you know, so. Yeah, so anyway, thank y'all.
When we play him next time too, we're going to tune down even lower.
Yeah, we're going to tune down like B or something. Yeah, like death metal. Yeah.
To see yourself.
All right. Thank you, Dragonfly, for hosting us tonight. Thank you, Famous Villain Stick Elliot. Eric Sparks, the man behind the camera, the man behind the show tonight. Happy birthday, man. And thank you for making us do this. Because we wouldn't have done it without you.
Happy birthday, Whippersnapper.
Yeah. So, yeah, seriously, y'all. And thank y'all that have made the road trip. Scott Allen Jones, thank you for driving your ass off to be here tonight. And, y'all, we really do appreciate it. And
in West Virginia, I could have been his father.
And thank you to Rich and Boo for being here with us tonight too, because I feel as though they were. So anyway, all right, y'all go get some food, go home and all that good stuff, and we'll see you again sometime. Bye.